So, welcome to the SGU, and we look forward to the closeout of the S-Cloud meeting. With me is Marc Bourgeois, with whom we follow together on the project, and the consortium members. Marc, do you have a few words you would like to share with us?
Secure Data Cloud is probably the most innovative of the second wave of WorkPackage E projects. And we are very happy to have the consortium here with Emre and Massimiliano. And we will split the presentation in two parts. There will be technical presentation, and then there will be a demonstration of the tool. Thank you very much for this kind introduction. And so I'm going to present to you the results and what we have done in this project that has in the last 2 years of activity. So Secure Data Cloud is a project that was born with a simple idea in mind. And the idea was, how can we deal with the problem of trust in AT and ATM, that is air transport and air traffic management? I will use AT and ATM as interchangeably, but essentially the both problems can be tackled by the same idea. So the problem of trust is that there are many situations in air transport in which we need several stakeholders to compute or to perform some computation in a collaborative way, that is sharing some information. But this is not really simple because of the value and the business value of the information that they have to share. So some examples are, for instance, lot market mechanism. So let's suppose we have a couple of airlines that want to buy a slot from an airport, and they have to agree a price, and they have to perform a slot trading, an auction, if we want, in order to get this slot. We can think about carbon dioxide allowance trading. We can think about other problems, like, for instance, benchmarking of different airlines. We can suppose that different airlines may want to understand which one of them is the most efficient and which one has the best position in the market. What is the problem here? The problem is that, of course, they have to share information in order to calculate this kind of value. So we can think that, for instance, in a slot trading mechanism, there is a very important piece of information that should be shared, that is the price of the slot, which is quite complicated because the price of the slot is strictly related with some business information that are private to the airline and that they usually don't want to share with the other. We can think about safety records. It would be really nice to have a possibility to compute some information about all the safety data that we have in the system. But the problem is that each stakeholder doesn't want really to share, to communicate this kind of information to all the other in an open way. And of course, any kind of business information is quite difficult to share, to openly share. So what is the solution? Well, there are a couple of solutions. The first one is the simple one, and is the one that is mostly used in the world. And this to select or to elect a kind of trusted super party. So what we do in this case is that we say, okay, there is an organization or an individual or whatever, or a company that we all trust. So we can just send all the data that we have to this company, to this super partner, and just let the super partner perform the computation, and then we will receive the result back. Of course, this is a problem of trust, because you don't have just to trust the organization in itself, because we may think that, for instance, okay, Eurocontrol, EASA, or whatever is a good organization and we trust them. The point is that you have to trust all the people inside this organization and all the procedures also of the organization, because, of course, the security of this system is as weak as the weakest of the link of the chain. And so you really have to trust all the parts of the organization. So this is not simple. And we have also to think to some other technologies like SWIM, for instance. SWIM is a really important piece of technology in the future of ATM. It's really important and it's really powerful and will solve a lot of problems. But we believe that this problem will not be tackled by SWIM, because at the end, SWIM is a public secret key infrastructure that allows to share and to communicate information between different stakeholders. But this is not the same, because at the end, what you need, that is, with SWIM, two companies can share data, but at the end, they have to trust each other because the data is really transmitted between them. So we decided, someday we realized that there was a third possibility that was much better than these two, two that we have seen here, and this is the use of secure multi-party computation. So secure multi-party computation is something that is quite well known in the field of cryptography, even though it's quite recent. I think it's like 20 years that has been seriously studied. And the idea of secure multi-party computation is, in principle, quite simple. is a set of techniques, of cryptographic techniques, that allows us to perform some kind of computation over data, over a set of data. These data are private, that is, each party participating in the computation has a part of this data, and they don't want to share the data. That is, we want to perform a computation without directly accessing the data of other parties. But we want just to get the final result, and we should not be able to get any other kind of information out of it. So it seems really strange. At the beginning, actually, we were a little bit surprised by the fact that this could be done. So I want to show you a very simple example of secure computation, because I think that it will clarify a lot of issues. This is a very simple example. Let's suppose that we have three parties, Alice, Bob and Charlie, and they want to perform a secure computation. That is, each one of them has a number, XA, XB and XC, and they want to sum this number, and all of them, they want to get the sum of these three numbers. But of course, Alice doesn't want Charlie to know what is the value of XA, and Bob doesn't want Alice to have the value of XB, and so forth. So what they can do, there's a very simple protocol here that is the following. Alice takes her number, she has to sum this random number R, so we suppose that is a random number that is big enough and has so good statistical properties. So she sums these two numbers and sends them to Bob. Bob receives R plus XA, and of course Bob cannot get any information out of it because Bob doesn't know R, so doesn't know also XA. What Bob can do is then to sum to this number his own secret number and send the result to Charlie. Charlie can do the same. So Alice will receive R plus A, B and C. Then she can just subtract R and broadcast the result, that is the sum. So as you can see in this case, in this very simple case, let's put some numbers in here, and you will see that in this case Alice has 4 and the random number is 10. You can do all the calculations, should be correct. So at the end, the point is that no one of these parties has information about the input number provided by the other parties. So the computation is more or less secure, but they can still perform this computation in a collaborative way. Of course, this is a very simple example. Reality is quite more difficult than this, also because you can think that, of course, if two of these parties collide, they can get the third number and so forth. So this protocol is really simple. It's a very basic example. We will see some more during the presentation, some more serious example of secure computation. But what is more important is that with this we can do a set of things. What can we do? Sadly, right now in the literature, the state of the art is not advanced enough to be able to perform any kind of computation. There are some restrictions, but what we can do for sure are simple mathematical operations, which allows us at the end to perform some benchmarking and secure analysis of, for instance, biomedical records. These are examples that have been drawn from real applications. Like the first one is quite famous, is a benchmarking of financial information of telecommunication companies, in which they decided to create this benchmark using secure computation, and it was actually quite successful. You can do sortings, and when you have sorting at the end you can do auctions, and this is also an interesting example of secure auction of sugar beets in Denmark, if I'm not wrong. Then you have some more complex operations that you can perform. In this case, there are a couple of examples. The first one is quite interesting. They are trying, and they think that they are deploying a commercial solution to try to avoid satellite collisions without having to get the full trajectory of all the satellites. This is really important for the military field because they don't want just to share the trajectories of their satellites, but still they have the problem of collisions in space. So with this background, what we wanted to do within Secure Data Cloud? Well, we had a vision, and the vision is, first of all, we wanted to demonstrate that secure multi-party computation is really useful in air transport and ATM. In terms of business relevance, what we wanted to do is to say, okay, let's community, let's have a look at this ATM community, because really we can solve a set of problems by means of this. We wanted also to develop a set of ready-to-deploy software libraries that could be used to solve different problems in ATM. Also, see how these libraries could be deployed in a cloud environment, which is, of course, one of the main points of IT today. And at the end, show that this is feasible by means of two case studies. So this presentation is going to be organized more or less as follows. So first of all, my colleague Emilio is going to present to you how we constructed and deployed an SMC solution that is composed of different software libraries. And then Emre will present to you real examples, scenarios that we have applied and in which the secure computation is was useful. So I will leave the floor to Emilio.
Thank you. Okay, so the objective was clearly to try to develop a software and to demonstrate that the solutions that were developed had a business sense and a technical feasibility and a legitimate cost. I will put in here what were the basic conclusions, the final product that we were able to design. We decided that there must be multi-computations, highly distributed computation, because one of the most important things in secure multi-party computation is that you don't have a real authority that can gather all the data, even if they are all encrypted. So the consortium decided to design these libraries that represent a way that can be used in other applications, in other contexts, in other environments. It's specifically a library, not an application. The application would come later with the simulation models. So a client-side and a server-side libraries, which in itself, it's already a little bit different as typical cloud solutions. We took and we did some extensive market analysis on the solutions, if there was any primitives, frameworks already in the field, to avoid to rewrite things that were already written. And we found that the Sepia primitives, which is basically adding, subtracting, and things like that, were present. They were open source, easy to check, easy to use, and easy to integrate in the overall view.
Sorry, you mentioned you did an extensive market analysis, yeah. Or did you do an extensive literature review? What did you do?
But the extensive literature review was on the algorithms part of that, to determine, for instance, that secure secret sharing was a good solution for the ATM mm-hmm. market on that. And based on this literature, which was algorithmic things, thinking about, we looked also to can we avoid programming things that have been already programmed at some university or whatever it is at a low level.
So that was the market analysis.
That was the market analysis. We found solutions that implemented things that were not open source, okay? So they were absolutely, you know, You cannot look at what was happening there. And we looked at what we could incorporate from these open source things. And it's true that at a basic level, a certain number of primitives were already there, but we have to construct everything to solve the solution around these primitives, okay? Does that answer your question? On these primitives, we have to implement the protocols where we have here, in this part, a very rough schema of what is the protocol. It means who will input which data, how they will transfer between all the agents, because what we implement is a secure message protocol on that. How we have clients, that are the airlines, that are the authorities, how we have servers, which have the computing tasks for them, which will be also distributed, and how all these elements interchange encrypted data along the computing procedure. A small detail also, which means that we were more efficient in other situations, it was that we developed that on the user story agile paradigm. What it means? It means that you define user stories and you combine, in a certain way, the establishment of a requirement with the immediate analysis of the requirement. It allowed to a more flexible way to get a solution. So the software delivery on the end, it's four libraries called Trader, Deliperfly, Deliperquoz, Airline Rankers. We build two type of environments in the consortium, a prototype to test that the libraries were okay. And then when they were demonstrated these in prototype, they were okay, these libraries were delivered to simulation models. We'll be discussing a little bit more later. We did a lot of efforts to be sure that these libraries did solve the problem in a good and efficient and tested way so that can be easily productized in a further step outside the project. So what we have implemented is something which can be embedded in a complete bidding process with, I wouldn't say 1,000 bidders, but in ATM it's not 1,000 bidders, it's usually as a maximum some tens of users. Also a complete delay benchmark process with a delay on a specific airport. Again, this is not a problem of thousands of people putting inputs, but tens of people putting inputs and it worked okay. And we demonstrated that the computational costs and the scalability of the solution were enough, so it can really be implemented in a real environment without throwing everything over and starting again. We have shown that the computational costs are absolutely acceptable with a standard low-cost server and hardware. We organized things in a way that we were able to address and to identify at least what those specific cloud SMC problems are to be tackled.
What were the criteria you used for tackling?
It was to be evidently a cloud implementation, but a cloud implementation very often has got some kind of central authority, the one who operates the cloud, let's say, okay? Dropbox, or whatever it is, or even Aerocontrol. In the SMC paradigm, you cannot have one authority that gathers all the data. You have to distribute the administrative things and the technical capabilities. So it's an over-distributed cloud solution. So we were able to identify the main architectural blocks and the main issues, which are not investigations, are system integration issues. So we designed a solution, we focused on a solution that has no central authority with all the data, but we need a validator. Let us say, for instance, that you need some time reference. It's a very simple technical thing. You need a time reference for everyone. Okay, but this time reference did not be associated with who is really doing the computation and this type of thing. What we found certainly is that getting to the real industrial process in production, there are still some challenges which are not part of the project, which will be part of in production project. As you can see, for instance, in here, in the lower part of that, the complexities of integrating nowadays, maybe in 5 years will be different, the complexity to integrate the development environment with the production environment in a cloud 24/7 computation capabilities. So that's the basic ideas about the libraries we were able to develop, okay? Thank you.
Actually, in that case, we have focused real examples regarding the slope trading and dynamical landing queues and analysis of delay reports. So in that sense, actually, we have developed simulation models and some data provisions for case studies. If you come to slope trading case, actually, let me first introduce some notations. For example, primary market. Primary market means slots are sold by airports to airlines. Secondary market means slot trading occurs between the airlines. And we have strategic and operational market. Strategic market means the slots are sold for some period. It's planned before. So operational means the tactical. So slot trade occurs during the operation. Tactical operation means real time, actually. So actually, we have considered three different scenarios here. Scenario 1, 2, 3. In the scenario 1, airlines try to buy slots from the airport. This is strategic and primary market. In the second scenario, airlines try to buy slots from another airline. This is again strategic but secondary market. In the third scenario, airlines try to buy a priority approach from an airport. This is operational. This is tactical market, actually. So this shows the, you know, timeline for those scenarios.
Emir, just one question.
Yes.
On these scenarios, what were the criteria which you used for the selection?
Actually, we are trying to, you know, find different examples from the strategic market and operational market. Mm-hmm. So this is typical, you know, to buy some slots before the, you know, in advance, maybe 6 months. So this is more close to, you know, operational side. So you can change your slots between the airlines, and this one, the, you know, operational, purely operational, you can buy your priority landing queue during your operation. So we are trying to select different time frames from the complete markets, actually. This shows the simulation model, general simulation model, actually slot trading and dynamic landing queues. We have first market, of course. In the market, we have commodity, we have slots to sell. We have market interest. In that case, the buyers are airlines. According to market interest and the slots to sell, we are calculating, we are gathering all the bits, we are gathering all the slot interest through the secure multi-party computation engine and some portals, web-based portals, and we are deciding who is the winner, if there is a tie or we should do another cycle. So this is the typical market or scenarios, actually, for all those three scenarios. If you back to scenario one, we are trying to create a market and slot interest. To do that, to put on the real cases,
First, we are calculating, we are putting some slope allocation model looking at the historical data. We are processing real data to get the real interest on the historical slopes. But when we get to looking at the historical real data, you are getting the balanced schedules, balanced slope schedules. To add some competitiveness, we are adding some randomness into the market to get some trade using the slope interest decision model. After that, we are going to secure multi-party computational library, and we are getting new slopes for the airports. In the first thing, based on the previous research actually, for data-driven ATM queuing model, it's like this. We are getting data-driven slope allocation using Eurocontrol DDR2 OLFD data. We are getting balanced slopes allocated to all those airlines, but these are the balanced. After that, to put some competitiveness, because we are trying to create a market, we are trying to create a trade, we are adding some randomness. This is just simple model. One can change this model. One can use complex business interest. But in our case, in our simulation model, we are adding some randomness to initial guess of slot allocation model. This is getting from the real data. When we add those randomness, we are creating market, we are creating competitiveness to get the trade. After that, we are gathering all those bids from the airlines. In that case, buyers are airlines. We are collecting all those bids and we are getting new schedules for the airport and airlines. When we go to scenario 2, this is kind of similar, but in that case, airlines are seller. They are changing slots using their own slots, available slots. In that sense, this is strategic and secondary market. We have slot interest decision model for the airlines. They are trying to change some slots. We are getting some new interest. We are going to simulation tool through the secure multi-party computation library, and we are getting new schedules for the airlines. When we look at our slot interest decision model for the scenario 2, the idea behind the concept is that airlines are interested in selling non-scheduled or least frequently used slots. Airlines are interested in buying the slots around their most frequently used slots. For example, you have most frequently used slots, mostly delayed. You are trying to get some different slots around your most frequently used slots. So this is the simple model to get new trade, to get new competitiveness. So you are trying to change, you are trying to switch the slots using your slot interest model. It's very similar. You are collecting all those bids regarding the slot interest decision maker, and you are calculating bids. You are looking at the, you know, if there is a winner, if there is a tie. So you are getting new schedules for airlines. When we go to scenario 3, this is purely operational, purely tactical. Airlines try to buy a priority approach from an airport. When we get the slot interest decision, we are evaluating en route delays for each landing aircraft using the OLFD data. This is the real data. If it's more than 30 minutes, airline is interested in buying a priority slot to balance their delay. So it's kind of sliding window. So you are trying to looking at these two slots. We have 30 minutes here to open to trade. It's like sliding window. According to the sliding window, you can buy a priority landing using the airport's commodity here. Actually, we have developed web-based simulation portal for the slope trading and dynamic landing queues. In that sense, you can go to log into your web-based portal. You can create a new slope trade here. You can put some bidding, you can put some minimum price for slots if you are the seller. So referee can end action, can see the results like this. So this was the web-based simulation portal for the wedge batch processor. This is the example looks. For example, referee create an action for slot 57. And seller bell sends the minimum price for this slot. THY is putting some price here. PGT is putting some price here. And referee close the action, waiting for the results. There is no winner because it's lower than the minimum price. So referee opening this action again, seller putting the minimum price, other ones putting the price and the waiting results, winner is the THY. So this is how this web-based portal is working actually.
Before we come to the conclusions, I just want to ask you some clarification question. In the beginning of your presentation on slide 2, you had market interest. My question was, how do you gather, how do you analyze the market interest?
This is quite complex because, you know, it's completely depends on the airline's interest. So we just try to put randomness. So it's kind of, you know, model. You can use the very complex models if you can get, you know, some interest regarding your Godfather rules and other things. But just we are to add some randomness to create this trade, actually.
In fact, you start from the current situation and you perturb it
exactly.
a bit
okay.
to create, recreate
exactly.
some variation mm-hmm. to
exactly.
the situation.
Exactly. This was the case.
And do you refer also as market generation to the same process? Or because during your presentation, you mentioned many times market generation, market generation.
Market generation, I mean, if you put some slow to trade, actually,
okay.
it's like market. So okay. you can put, you can sell, you can buy. Mm, this
okay.
is the market.
Okay, so that's what you meant.
Yeah,
okay.
exactly. When we come to conclusion, actually, we have tried to create a simulation based on primary and secondary market, including the real time, it was the priority lending. Considering the needs such trade, we have developed web-based simulation portal. You can lock the system, you can put your slot, you can put your minimum price for the slot, you can bid for the slot. And through the batch simulation, we have tried to demonstrate the feasibility of such business for slot trade, actually. In addition, the secure information sharing using our secure multi-party computation, this structuring highly dynamic markets add benefits to airline, allowing to make their operation more flexible, more dynamic. So this is the benefits for the airlines. To assess the advantages of this business model, one can run this simulation through the real commercial interest using more complex market interest. So this was the result of our simulation. When we come to analysis of delay reports, which is other case study that we have worked on actually, in that sense, we are trying to create a system to delay reports using clear information coming from the different parties, and we want to do in a secure way. To do that, we are using secure multi-party computation library related to delay per flight, related to delay per calls, and airline ranking by means of total delay minutes. We have some statistical indicators for to calculate mean, median, standard deviation, and for ranking to get the maximum value. So to get to do real experiments, we have analyzed all IATA delay causes. So we reduced into the 13 causes that can be observed or data sets that we have, which are the OLFT plus data from Eurocontrol, capacity reports from Eurocontrol, ATM headlines from the network operation portal, and weather reports in online open portals using the METAR data. So when we have those 13 delay causes right here, and we have grouped into two, which calls can be seen by the network manager, which calls can be seen by the airline operation centers. We have prepared those formats to show the reference delay causes and to show some form to airlines and to network managers. In that case, we have flight IDs and all those delays for the arrival delay, departure delay, and we have 13 causes. These are the binary features. This is the reference data to show to airline representative and network manager representative. So one can see this reference data, the reference delay report, can create those forms for their own interest regarding who is the airline, who is the network manager. To do that, to create a simulation models to provide specific examples depending on the real data, we have looked at the weather cause delays, demand capacity problem cause delays, restriction, industrial action and special event cause delays, and aircraft rotation cause delays. To get the weather cause delays, we have searched the ATM related news and we tried to find the METAR data, associated METAR data. to get demand capacity problems, we searched the ATM headlines in the network operation portal, and we have got some notifications, which is similar to for the get the restriction and industrial actions. To get the aircraft rotation cause delays, we have processed all of the data to get the late arrivals, late departures. This is example from the simulation data, preparation of simulation data. For example, we have got this notification from the network operation portal. It says the heavy rain and storm in Vienna and Istanbul airports. And we are creating those reference delay reporting data. It says for each flight, there is these delays right here. And it says the causes regarding to weather-related data for the destination airport, origin airport, or en route. This binary feature says there is a weather-related problem for those delays, actually. Regarding to our library, secure multi-party computation library, we can analyze this by routes, we can do ranker, and we can analyze by cause of delays. So in that the analysis by routes, we are aggregating all information about flight delays and generating set of statistical description for the routes. For the ranker, we are comparing total delays one by one and sort in a secure way. To get the analysis by cause of delays, we are analyzing the delay data as a function of the cause of delays. This is web-based simulation portal again. Referee can create a report analyzing, can choose the route. When choose this route, can see the flights, can select this flight, and can select the delay causes to report. One participant can see all those flights and put some delays here regarding to causes, and we can get those results actually. Our web-based simulation portal also can handle the error. If you put the non-numerical, it says, okay, you enter wrong input, so please report the numerical things, and we can handle some errors here. So when we come to conclusion, actually, in this case study again, we try to assist them to gather different delay reports from different stakeholders. And we have developed web-based simulation portal enabling participants to see, open questionnaire, put some inputs. And we have tried to demonstrate using many real-world examples through the LFT data and other kind of things coming from the ATM headlines, METAR, and some weather-related news. And to get the inputs, we have used the experts from the ANSB, we have used the students here. So we have conceptually demonstrated the feasibility of such web-based reporting and secure analysis. And we have observed that manipulating the results is easy if one intentionally acts in biased manner in the, using this analyzing report here. So that was the my part.
I just want to close this presentation with, well, before the demo part, with a couple of final ideas about this project. So what we have achieved in this project. I think that at the beginning the project was quite, the concept was quite challenging. So at the end what we have achieved? We have achieved quite a lot. So first of all, we have raised awareness in the AT and ATM community. This being through the development of the case studies or the two case studies that we have seen, but also with strong interactions with the stakeholders in all the conferences and events in which we have participated. And we have to say that the feedback that we received was extremely good, in the sense that at the beginning people are a little bit surprised by the fact that we can do actually a secure computation. But then when they see that it's work, that it's possible, that it's feasible, all of them have proposed to us different problems in which secure multi-party computation can be used. So really we had a very good feedback from different stakeholders in the community. Second, we have created a set of libraries that are more or less ready to use in any, let's say, operational deployment. Of course, as any software libraries, this is not just a matter of downloading it, installing, and then everything will work. It's not that simple. Actually, you have to know a little bit how the system works. You have to solve some technical challenges, but the libraries are there. They are quite easy to use, and we really hope that the community, that SJU, that Cesar in general, will be able to take advantage of this part that we have done. And also we have validated the solution. Of course, at the beginning, we tried to validate the solution, but as this project is about trust, we did not trust ourselves, and we decided to go to the community, to the scientific community, to try this validation. And actually, we presented the solution to several international conferences, even one conference that was specific on information security. So there were a lot of people expert in this secure computation. They had a look at our solution, they analyzed our solution, and actually, there were quite positive, the feedback were quite positive in terms of the computational cost, the reduced computational cost that we achieved. So this is really good. This is what we have, I think, achieved in the project. And what is more important, I think that we have reached a TRL level of 3, in the sense that we have a set of elements that have been validated in a laboratory environment. Of course, we are a little bit still far away from the operational environment, but still in the lab we have used synthetic data and this works. And also, all these elements have been put together in a single solution, and also the solution has been validated. So I guess that we have reached TRL3, and we are ready for future implementation and operational studies. And we really hope that this solution that we have created can be used in the future. So this is all for this part. Of course, if you have questions, you can contact me or any of my colleagues.
If you go back to the conclusions, you did mention that you have created a library, right?
That's it.
And my question is, what are your plans for this library? How are you going to, is it going to be an open source library? What's, yeah.
Okay, our idea, and this has been documented in, if I'm not wrong, deliverable 2.2. The idea is that we are open to share these libraries with any SJU partner that will ask us to do that. So we are ready to share with any other partner these kind of libraries. Of course, what I want to stress is that this is not as simple as downloading a program and installing it in a computer and it will work. So it's quite a little bit more complicated. There are some technical issues that should be tackled each time one wants to perform a secure computation, like for instance synchronizing the time reference and so forth. So it's not just a matter of sending a zip file to someone else, but we are ready to support any SJU partner that wants to implement this.
What about non-SJU partners? What about researchers at the universities? And so is there a possibility like to have it like an open source type of platform or at least some information? Because for example, if you have a PhD student who may be interested in the future to use it, mm-hmm. maybe it could be...
Our idea is that we will check it case by case, so it will not be open source, and we will not distribute it freely, mm-hmm. let's say in the internet, but we are open to collaborate with, of course with PhD students or any other non-commercial application. If it's commercial, let's say that should be inside SJU, just to...
No, I'm talking about the non-commercial research activities, I believe that the solution you're proposing and these type of libraries could be of potential interest for future researchers or research activities.
We are with that.
So
we are
that's why I think it would be good to have some kind of a partial of some of these libraries as an open source, or at least consideration for that.
You used open source libraries. Some of them probably a viral license attached to them, which obliges you to make everything public as open source, which you have added onto those libraries.
There is a lot of things in open source. OSAPI is under common copyright. It means that they do not require that the things that you do with OSAPI is absolutely open source.
It's Creative Commons license.
Yeah, Creative Commons, exactly. The agreement of OSAPI is that you must mention that you have used it. As a matter of fact, we started with OSAPI framework, but we have modified certain components of this same framework because it didn't work quick enough, and we have multi-threaded others and things. So it's no more pure OSAPI. But we must recognize that we started with something which been developed by OSAPI people.
It's a complicated infrastructure. It's a fragile infrastructure, I understand, because you use software from different libraries, which evolve at different rates, and so knitting it all together creates a kind of maintenance headache still today. You said that maybe in a few years the platform will be more stable, more comprehensive, more...
You're right, and that's something we addressed in one of the deliverables, but that's the cloud point of view, not the secure multi-party algorithmic part of it. It's a distributed distributed cloud solution, which is necessary for this type of solution, which is still a system integration bit of nightmare. It's why nowadays, for instance, most of the cloud solutions are just one provider for one solution. You have Dropbox for this, not for other things. You have Dropbox for this. You have Microsoft for that, and Microsoft controls everything. A non-central cloud is a challenge in terms of IT. But so it was not the part of the project.
So if you had the customer asking you to do this, you would be reluctant at the moment?
Not at all, but it's my job to solve this type of problems. There was one challenge, which was the algorithms and the encryptions, the secure multiparticle. Now we understand how it works, and that you can do that with low hardware. Going to an operational implementation, now it turns to be IT things to solve. The challenge of IT is to make things IT work. It's no more a big investigation, it's solving integration problems one by one. It means money, certainly, but it's not a challenge.
In the future, we are thinking of various ways here in the EGU to have a place, maybe a consolidated place, where we have all work packaging projects, the open source metrics or tools or so on. Would it be a potential interest for you in the future to be part of that?
Yeah, for sure.
Okay.
Yeah.
So
absolutely.
Okay.
Yeah.
These type of libraries, just for interest to know. My second question is, you said you reached TRL 3 solution. Mm-hmm. Pretty much. How did you make that conclusion? I mean, how did you?
Well, because according to the definition of TRL levels, TRL 3 is when you have different elements that have been validated in a lab environment and then have been integrated together and also being validated in a lab environment.
Sure.
So what we have done here, the elements are, let's say, the different libraries, the SMC mm-hmm. libraries. They have been validated from a software point of view and a mathematical point of view. And then what we have done, we have created the online system, the web-based system that integrates all these libraries. And we have tested it using realistic data. So it's not real data, as it has been created in a synthetic way, but it's the kind of data that would expect in a real application. Okay. So we really believe that we have reached TRL 3.
And also for the business cases, Mary, too?
Yeah, actually, we reached the TRL 3, actually, because, yeah, this is synthetic. We have created some data mm-hmm. in synthetic way, but we are based on the, you know, real data. So if we one can, you know, put real complex market mm-hmm. interest, but this is, you know, not open to anyone.
Yeah.
So this is completely up to, you know, airline. So one airline can, you know, use all those library and this web-based simulation portal to, you know, run their own simulation.
Okay, and my final question is, I think the project is very interesting, very good result, but what is, based on your research result, based on what you have identified now, what are your recommendations for future research? How can we follow? I would like to hear each of you from your point of view, because you've worked on different deliverables.
Perfect. I would say I will give two answers. The first one is from a more mathematical and cryptographic point of view. I think that we have to start developing libraries that are specific for the problems that we have to tackle in ATM. So right now we have used open source libraries and so forth. Open source elements, which are good, but maybe we should be able to optimize them to the kind of problems that we are tackling here. And the second one, I think that, of course, it would be really nice to go to higher TRL levels. For instance, by thinking on how to integrate this secure multiparty computation in a SWIM environment, that is, to be able to use SWIM as a platform or as an infrastructure to perform this kind of computation. I think this is quite challenging. It's not simple because SWIM, of course, is a very is a technology, is an infrastructure that has other objective, not just perform computation this way. But I think that this would be really beneficial for the community.
Why is it difficult to move this to SWIM?
Well, because I think, although I'm not an expert, that SWIM has been specifically created to share information, not to perform computations. So we have to adapt all the libraries and all the SMC solutions in order to use SWIM as a communication channel
but not as a platform to perform computation. Then the computation should be executed in a distributed way over all the parties taking part in the computation.
Because you could add your computational servers as nodes onto the SWIFT network. You have your clients, which are the airlines, the network manager, and so forth. You have the SWIM doing the communication, and then you have back-end clients, so to speak, that actually do the S-Cloud secure multi-party computation. That would be a bit expensive in terms of...
Yeah, that would be, conceptually, there is no big difficulty, because that's one of the basic functions of the SWIM. We will need to add to the technology that now is implemented in SWIM, which is essentially SOA, between information providers and information consumers. SWIM is some kind of basic standard plus broker. We would need technically to add the capabilities to have the software and to distribute the software for those who want to compute the server and those who want to make the process. Conceptually, I wouldn't see any problem. Technically, yes, you will need to expand the technical standards which are nowadays implemented in SWIM.
Okay. So in actually university point of view, actually, we are looking at the feasibility of those libraries. So if you improve to in research way, if we improve to this, actually we have to compare with the existing operation. So we should look at the, you know, more complex business models. For example, using those things, using those markets, actually we can look at the, you know, price models. You can compare the price models for different, you know, OD pairs, using those kind of case studies and those kind of secure multi-party computation libraries. This was, you know, this will improve this research regarding to, you know, this secure multi-party computation using those case studies, actually.
Okay, thank you, Amri.
From a human technical perspective, there is two challenges that we would like to tackle, okay? Mm-hmm. One is going to an implementation phase, capable of being of in implementation. In the context of SWIM or SWIM modified, or going to the IT solution, let's say. That can be a very important thing because there is a big business advantage in here. There is also another part which is more strictly SMC. As we have said, we are now doing sorting, we are doing benchmarking on delay reports and things like that, but there are a certain number of problems, like, for instance, flight negotiation, real-time flight negotiation, which is very similar to the problem of satellite collision, no? Mm-hmm. That's on the frontier of the capabilities nowadays of SMC and the existing hardware. So one challenge is, let's say, more IT-oriented with a big business advantage, and the other one is to progress with new techniques of SMC.
So this is an area of future long-term research, which you see?
The second one, yes. The first one is more implementing things. It's more making them work, really. The other one, yes, it's a more long-term research. And people are already working on new algorithms, homomorphic algorithms, for instance, for those type of complex problems, mm-hmm. which are linked to a lot of calculations, which must be done very quickly.
Thank you. Any questions, Mark, on your
Well, side? That is the last, the ultimate question. We will see the demo. And then, of course, it's a matter of trust. It's like, has man ever gone to the moon? You've seen video images, has he been there? So how can you give me that level of trust that this is really working? I warned you throughout the project that you should be thinking about how to prove that it's not a mock-up, that it is a real implementation.
Well,
it's not the Google Lunar X.
It's a very complicated question, and especially the answer is complicated. The best way of looking at that is we give to you the source code and you look at the libraries. That's why we have used open source libraries. One of the reasons was just that, because in this way we have a community of researchers that have demonstrated that these libraries are really doing what they are. They're saying that way.
But then you're not sharing it with them, are you?
No, we have the source code.
Yeah, okay.
We can inspect.
If you want, of course, you are more than welcome to. This, I think, that will be the best solution.
And that's the best solution for this and for any security solution, always.
But has there not been, you know, like there have been clever people thinking of these secure multi-party computations, have they also not been thinking of an inspection method to really guarantee to the user that what is pretended to be happening is actually happening?
No, for a very simple reason. So you're proposing that we can create some kind of algorithm that is able to, for instance, check the information that is exchanged between the servers that are performing the computation
and that is able to detect, okay, they are actually doing the computation, is not a trick or is not. The problem is that if you can't do that, the computation is not secure, because you can extract information, but just looking at the communications between the server, you know if they are performing a computation or not. This is against the principle of secure multi-party computation. You should not be able, from any point of view, to extract information about the computation itself. So it's quite complicated. It's quite a complicated program.
You said that from the very beginning of the project, so that's not, we've been discussing. Is there a way to demonstrate it in terms of programming or whatever the data or whatever it is, but we couldn't find any other way that looking into the code.
Yeah, but in this case, you claim you have reached TRL 3 for your project. If we want to mature further, or the solution needs to be properly validated.
It's different to validate that you implemented a good algorithm that can be shown. It's different to implement that you have implemented a good model of the users. Let's say that the majority of the users are passive observers and so on and so on. That can be done, okay? But you will always get the problem to say, okay, this can be done, but how can you demonstrate that you cannot fake the validation? And to be sure that you didn't fake the validation, it's a chain of trust, you will need to have the code. On the last issue, you will need the code. It's different validating the system. That means we are reasonably confident that we have made all the tests and all the user stories, so the system corresponds to what we expect him to do. The other thing is it really secure up to now? Isn't any backdoor on the software that we have produced? You know, you can think of tests about backdoors, but there will be always another backdoor. In that, there is no other real important thing that the software being scrutinized by knowledgeable people. There is no other way. It's the same way, for instance, for encryption, SSL, TSL, and whatever it is, it's the way it is done, yeah?
Okay.
You're welcome.
And I think that now we can move to the demo of the system.
The referee needs to log into Portal in order to create a new auction by filling the required username and password sections. The username of participant is demonstrated at top left corner. The last operated auction is located at the bottom of the page. The each column on the table represents different information. The first one is auction ID, the second one is description of slot, the third one is seller of the auction, and the last column indicates status of the auction. To navigate to auction creating page, the referee should press start a new auction link. This page requests some details about new auction, such as auction name, seller of auction, end time and number of privacy pairs. After filling requested informations, it is enough to press submit button to create a new auction. It is okay. The auction is able to shown at the bottom of the page, and participants can send their bid prices. The first participant is Turkish Airlines, the seller of new auction. The participant can access each auction by pressing select link on the apply column. Also, it is possible to see new auction at the bottom of the page. The user trader page enables sending bid prices for available auctions. To send the bid price to server, the participant should enter his value to bid price text box and should press the send price button. If the participant is the seller of the selected auction, then his price is set as minimum price. In this scenario, Turkish Airlines is the seller and entered 1,500, so this is the minimum price of this auction. The second participant is Lufthansa Airlines. And Lufthansa, send 750, which is lower than minimum price. The third participant is KLM Airlines. And KLM sends 900, which is also lower than minimum price too. The last participant is Iberia. Iberia, send 600, this price is lower than minimum price. Bid prices are stored on the system securely and, after the referee press end auction button, the computation starts. Then, the status of the auction indicates computing message. Since all bid prices of participants are lower than minimum price of Turkish Airlines, no winner message is shown at the end of the computation. This is the default scenario, which demonstrates a competition between participants set over minimum price. The referee creates a new auction with the same informations, and also the seller is Turkish Airlines again. Turkish Airlines sends 800 to the system for minimum price. Lufthansa sends 1500. The bid price of the participant, who is not the seller of this auction and just desires to buy selected slot, is compared with bid prices of the other participants. Air France sends 1250. United Arab Emirates sends 2,000, which is the maximum value. The referee ends the auction. The result is illustrated on the last column after the computation process. United Arab Emirates wins the auction with 2,000. The referee is directed to the Delay Per Flight Analysis selection page by clicking on the Delay Per Flight link in the navigation menu above the tables. The Delay Per Flight page provides analysis information to the referee about the name of the analysis, the number of privacy pairs and the status of analysis. The form for creating a Delay Per Flight analysis meets the requirement of the referee to generate a new analysis about a route. The first combo box is filled by observing each OD pairs stored in database. The creating a new delay per flight analysis, the information of the form is sent to the server by pressing the submit button. Furthermore, the number of privacy pairs, which is displayed on the third column, affects the computation performance. The participant, which is an airline or network manager, is directed to the Delay Per Flight Analysis selection page by clicking on the Delay Per Flight link in the navigation menu above the tables. The participant selects an analysis from the list of available Delay Per Flight analysis, so he is directed to the User Delay Per Flight page by the simulation portal. The Delay Per Flight page provides a way of sending delay reports for a flight in a secure way. This tool is used by airline and network managers. Text boxes enable writing values of delays for the flights on the same column. The participant should press the Send Delay Report button in order to post his report to the SMC servers. In this example, pair number 2, which is an airline, reports 8 minutes for DLH-914 and 10 minutes for DLH-6JA. Also, the network manager of peer number 2 reports 12 minutes for DLH-914 and 14 minutes for DLH-6JA. To finish the data gathering process, the referee should press the End Analysis button. in order to start the computation, and, to complete it successfully, there must be, at least two clients. The result related to the delay minutes of all the flights, in mean, median, and standard deviation, are displayed on the last column of the table. The secure delay per causes analysis defines a system of delay reports using cleared information, which are reported by different participants. The delay per causes page provides analysis information to the referee about the name of analysis, the number of causes, and the number of flights that are on a relevant route. This page enables to create a new delay per causes analysis for gathering delay reports from participants. When the referee selects a route from the first combo box, flights which are operated on the selected route are returned from database according to the selection. The referee may configure various scenarios by selecting only one airline flights, or by selecting all of the listed flights. On the delay causes part of the table, 13 delay causes codes are shown as defined by International Air Transport Association, including ATC capacity, weather, or special events, etc. The new delay per causes analysis is sent to the server by pressing submit button. The participant select an analysis from the list of available delay per causes analysis, so he is directed to the user delay per causes page by the simulation portal. It is possible to get information about the route which is available for delay per causes analysis. The number of causes and number of flights are also displayed on this page. Participants are categorized into two groups, and they are able to report only the causes assigned to them. The figure on below indicates the cause assignments for the airline and network manager. The delay per causes analysis requires gathering a detailed delay report from the participants, such that each of the flights on the relevant route is listed and each of the delay causes is assigned to them. The columns that represent causes codes may vary according to the referee selection. To send the delay values, the participant should press the Send Delay Report button. The network manager of Pier Number 1 reports 10 minutes delay for KLM 38P because of departure station delay. Then, he reports 12 minutes for destination delay and 6 minutes for ATFM restriction at destination airport. And the other participants send their delay reports by using the simulation portal in a secure way. Finally, the network manager of peer number 3 sends his delay report. To finalize the data gathering process, the referee should press the end analysis button. In order to start a computation and to complete it successfully, there must be at least 3 clients and 3 servers. During the computation process, a computing message is displayed on the last column of table. When the computation finishes, a set of statistical descriptors including the average delay time, total delay time and standard deviation etc. are displayed on the last column. The first array elements represents total delay minutes per cause. The second array elements indicates the number of non-zero inputs per cause, the third one represents mean value per cause, and the last one represents standard deviation per cause. The simulation portal aggregates the inputs of the participants and calls the secure computation in order to generate a secure descending sorting, ensuring at all times the privacy of the data. The referee is able to create a new ranking analysis by using the Create Ranking page. Firstly, the referee should put the name of the ranking analysis to the first row. Then, if any filtering is needed, he can select participants. Furthermore, the number of privacy peers, which was displayed as a combo box, can be selected by the referee. The information for creating a new ranking analysis is sent to the server by pressing the Submit button. The participant selects an analysis from the list of available rankings, then he is directed to the user ranking page by the simulation portal. If an airline wants to know his position in a list which is sorted by the total delay, he needs to report his total delay value with this form. The participant fills up the text box and presses the send button in order to deliver the value to the system. Three clients and three servers are the minimum numbers for starting and to successfully complete the computation. When the computation finishes, airlines are displayed in descending order on the last column. For this example, FedEx is the most delayed airline. The simulation portal checks each delay causes according to the user type, so, when the participant reports an unassigned delay, the system warns the participant with the cause name. In this example, peer number 2 is an airline and he is not responsible to report delay for ATFM due to the restriction at destination airport. The participant, who is a network manager, tries to send aircraft rotation delay, however, a network manager cannot report a delay because of aircraft rotation. If checking operations are completed successfully, then the simulation portal delivers all input values to the SMC server. Otherwise, an error message is displayed on the screen with the name of the flight and the cause of wrong input.